Hey guys, my name is Jaden, and today we're going to be breaking down how I got into 14 top schools, as well as answering some of your questions. For reference, I was accepted to MIT, WashU, Rice, Tufts, Duke, Johns Hopkins, Carnegie Mellon, Columbia, Yale, UPenn, Brown, Caltech, Georgia Tech, and the University of Florida. I was waitlisted at Harvard, Cornell, and Dartmouth, and rejected from Princeton, Stanford. But today we're going to dive into it and maybe find out why. For some background, I am from Orlando, Florida. Orlando's not really the most competitive region academically, but the school I went to was very rigorous. To start off, we'll be talking about grades and GPA. My school was on a 4.0 unweighted scale and a 5.0 weighted scale, and dual enrollment and AP courses were worth those 5 points, but the majority of classes we took were AP. One thing to note is we didn't have a choice but to take AP classes. I think everyone graduates with at least taking 11 AP courses, and there wasn't another version you could take. However, I still worked really hard and took a bunch online, so I ended up graduating with 16 AP courses, and you can see my scores and those classes broken down by STEM and non-STEM here. On top of AP courses, I also took 2 dual enrollment classes. I did biology and calculus 3 through the University of Florida. I got A's in those too, so, you know, a little boost to my GPA. I never got below an A in high school, and my final unweighted GPA was a 4.0. My weighted GPA, though, was a 4.64-ish, around that range. But at the time of submitting my college applications, I was class ranked number 1 out of 102 students. What happened the last week of school, though, in terms of my class rank, is a story for another time. Next up is standardized testing. So my school offered the SAT 3 times and the ACT twice. I took it all the times that they offered it, but as you can see by my scores here, I could never get higher than a 1480. It's actually really interesting because my sophomore year was the only time I took it on paper. The rest was digital. So digital is supposed to be easier, but I couldn't score higher on the digital. I wasn't too stressed about it though, because my ACT scores were much higher comparatively. My highest super score was a 35, and since colleges don't really have a preference over the ACT or SAT, I just submitted my ACT everywhere and not my SAT. Interestingly though, the only school that did see my SAT score was MIT because they required it, but I still got in, even though I got the lowest score the last time that I took it, which is, you know, it is what it is, and I guess it really didn't matter in the long run. Now onto my activities. I filled out 10 activities on the Common App, and I'll go through each of them one by one. The first one was me creating STEM day and summer camps for younger kids in my community to teach them about my school and kind of encourage them to apply. My senior year, I also founded a nonprofit where I teach students how to create their own STEM programs. So the top 2 of my activities were really, really STEM education focused. The next one, my third one, was I led a math tutoring program for kids on campus. I was also National Honor Society Vice President. I was band vice president, aka band captain, for a marching and concert band. I was a student government vice president of events. I also had some STEM internships across a couple summers, and I was a student ambassador for my school and school district. I was a playwriting competition team captain. And lastly, I put that I sang in the shower. This is actually a really interesting one. I'll talk about it a little. There was so much other stuff I could put, like my junior year, I was yearbook photography manager and model new one vice president, but that didn't even show up on my application. I put that I sang in the shower because it was something really important to me. I love singing. I'm singing all the time. And I felt like I really wanted to show my authentic self to colleges. And I actually talked to an admissions officer at one of the schools, and she was like, yeah, I saw that and I laughed. So be funny on your application, be yourself. Don't try and fit a mold, because you know that doesn't show your real self. In this section, I'll also include additional information, which is also on the Common App. I talked a little bit about how COVID impacted my family. Unfortunately, a couple of my family members had passed away and or had long-term health issues, which was a really big financial burden on my family. I also talked about how I expanded what I did in my nonprofit. I kind of clarified that. I spoke about how my school didn't have research or Olympiad opportunities, hence the lack of them on my application. This was mostly because I was super, super worried, like, oh my gosh, MIT and all these top schools, I'm going against all these Olympiad winners and I don't have any of that. It really doesn't matter in the end. I also clarified time commitments for some activities. I had a lot of 3D modeling certifications that I couldn't put anywhere else, so I put those under additional information. I also talked about some independent research projects that I did, and also I volunteered at my church as a barista. So, to moral of the story, always, always, always use the additional information section. It might not be, you know, the thing that makes or break your application, but it definitely provides some additional context, talks some more about who you are as a person, clarifies things. It's really a great space that you should elaborate on whatever you want to talk about. Next up are honors and awards. I was terrified for this section a million times over because, like, along the same lines of not having Olympiads or research, I was like, oh my gosh, I do not have enough, you know, awards to even put in here. But I made it work. I was Sunshine State STEM Scholar, which is like a STEM award given to 2 kids per county in Florida. I put an academic achievement award that I had gotten at my school just for having a high GPA. I was Student of the Year in 10th grade, AP with We Service recognition for a Spanish project that I did. I had Spanish Seal of Biliteracy, and I also put some competition awards that I'd gotten from the playwriting thing that I talked about in my activity section. Overall, these weren't insane over-the-top awards. It was definitely no Olympiad, but I mean, it was genuine. And to be honest, I think that colleges really take time to emphasize that you are in the context of your school, not of the world at large, and they understand what opportunities are offered to you. Lastly are my essays. It took me forever to come up with an essay topic, but I ended up writing this one the last kind of week before the application deadline. I will read the first and closing sentences. I won't read the whole thing. 1610. On January 7, 1610, Galileo Galilei gazed deeply into the night sky. Past the glare of a homemade telescope and through the noise of a vibrant celestial expanse, he discovered the first satellite orbiting another planet, Europa. Unbeknownst to Galileo, in 1610, my dream was born. And then to end it, I go like this. Today, hundreds of years ago, a homemade telescope observed the final destination. Unbeknownst to Galileo, on January 7, 1610, our stories had just begun. Like a rocket, I will never stop rising, bringing the dreamers of my past into an optimistic future. I have a dream that will not freeze, a dream that will drive me to the cosmos forever and always. Now, this essay was deeply personal to me. Not necessarily because I was like, oh, I'm gonna write this super fancy, you know, like philosophical essay, but more so that it was really a chance for me to talk about, you know, things from a different perspective. I really wanted to captivate my passion for not only STEM, but also how I wanted to help people get there. That was why I chose those first two activities as STEM education and outreach programs, because that's what I'm passionate about, as well as engineering. I talked about engineering, why I like sci-fi. I talked about what planets I want to explore, or moons, specifically Europa, of course. And I also talked about why I'm involved in service. And I guess this was a really nice thing that tied together my application in a way that a normal essay wouldn't. As for supplemental questions for colleges, there were so many. One thing that every college had though was a why major question. For that one, I pretty much just talked about how I'm a huge sci-fi nerd. I love sci-fi, and I want to create those technologies that will allow us to go to Mars or another planet in the future, you know, invent light speed travel. That's the goal. And some other stories that I had told were about my great grandparents. I mentioned this, but during COVID, they had passed away, unfortunately, and they only spoke Spanish since they were immigrants from Spanish speaking countries. And I really didn't know them because I didn't know Spanish. So I talked about how over the summer, I spent so much time like grinding Spanish, learning so that way I can talk to my existing great grandparents and have a relationship with them. I also talked about how I had to fight so hard to get my STEM camp off the ground and how those lessons had shown me how to eventually create a nonprofit in which I teach other people using my experience. So a whole bunch of different things about my life. Nothing super STEM focused. It doesn't always have to be about what your exact major is. Just show yourself and everything else will fall in line. The next part are letters of rec. So most schools had required a STEM letter of rec and humanities letter of rec. For each, I had my AP Physics teacher and my AP Spanish teacher. I had really strong relationships with them both. For physics was more academic, but my Spanish teacher, as well as being my Spanish teacher and seeing me in the classroom, struggling in AP Spanish because I didn't know Spanish. She was also the club sponsor for a bunch of clubs that I did. So I worked really closely with her and, you know, constantly fighting and battling and figuring out things together. Like, we made it work. So we really got to know each other as people. And it was really cool. I loved my teacher's great support system in my school. When I had the option to, I'd also include my superintendent as an additional letter of rec. He was the leader, of course, of the Superintendent Advisory Board Council that I was on. So we had worked closely as well, talking about things in the district that should change. So he knew my character and yeah, he knew me. Last but not least are the interviews. So I was interviewed from Harvard, Yale, Princeton, Duke, MIT, and Rice. Interestingly, I loved all the interviews. It was so cool to get to know them. They always ask really similar questions like why major, what's the challenge you face, how'd you overcome it, what's your favorite class? And for those, I was just really honest with them, genuine. Harvard though was very, very weird because both of my interviewers, unlike any of the other ones that I had, were super, super stoic. I say both because I actually got a second interview, which is crazy. Like, who gets a second interview from Harvard? But I did. Typically, I found out it's with an admissions officer. My second interview was not with an admissions officer, but I ended up not even getting in. I was waitlisted. So I wonder if maybe it was because of the interview or if the interview had something to do with it. I don't know. But it was just really interesting because I was so confident I would get in after having a second interview. The only other school that I had an interview from and I was also rejected was Princeton. But I'm pretty sure it's because I never did the Princeton specific financial aid portal. It's so weird because Princeton's the only school that I applied to, at least, to have their entirely unique application portal that you can't do through the CSS profile. And I didn't know that until like 3 months after I submitted my application, and they don't consider it complete until you submit the portfolio that they ask for. So yeah, I was kind of screwed over there. One other thing I want to mention is maker portfolios and supplementals. I had submitted some sort of supplemental regarding my STEM education camps to Columbia, MIT, and Tufts. Those are the only schools that I had kind of space on the application to do so. It's like a separate portal where you'll upload pictures and write a summary and things like that. MIT specifically asks for a maker portfolio. I might post that at a later date. You guys let me know if that's something you're interested in. But it wasn't like the maker portfolios you see online where people are like making robots and entire model car and things like that. I literally just had pictures and told my story like, hey, I wanted to help kids learn about STEM. So I did this like STEM program. And that's how I kind of shared my passion there. I really hope that it shined through. I mean, they say that they send it to staff members on campus, like engineering technical people or computer scientists. Mine didn't really fall in a specific STEM field since it was more education. But either way, it was still a great chance for me to get my story out there and show a different perspective of me. So now for Q&A, to answer some questions, a lot of people ask, what do you think makes you stand out? And to be honest, I think it was definitely the stories that I told. Like I had mentioned throughout this entire video, I never tried to force myself into any box. I told whatever I was feeling. You know, they would ask me about like, what's your STEM topic? And I'll talk about whatever I wanted to, because I knew that even if I'm talking about aliens and sci-fi and I'm an engineer, that's what I'm passionate about. And that's what they want to know. I also had a lot of unique stories to tell. I did a whole bunch of random extracurriculars. Like, I was in band, National Honor Society, math tutoring clubs. So very, very different things. And each of those had like an entirely different community that I got to meet and really connect with. And I think in doing so, I had so many different like things to talk about. I never struggled to write a supplemental essay because there was some point in my life where I had encountered that. I also did a lot in high school, which I wouldn't suggest. You know, I'd say if I can go back to really focus on what you're super, super passionate about and build that out. But I did have fun in the process. It was just very, very stressful. Another thing is what makes you stand out amongst your peers. I would like to mention that the school I went to wasn't necessarily competitive. We were super academically challenged. We had a million AP classes that we had to take. But I think at the end of the day, we were all in it together. And when we were going through classes, it wasn't like we were competing against one another. A lot of people see my school and they're like, oh, it's super competitive. It really wasn't. I think it was more so that even then, I always took it that next step. Like, I took as many AP classes online as I could, physically managing time. I did dual enrollment courses. I had to bang down my principal's door to let me even do calculus 3. A whole bunch of stuff that other students just weren't willing to do because they didn't care as much. And that's completely okay. But that's what really made me stand out in comparison to my peers, is that I would not take no for an answer. If you want something, go for it and do everything in your power to make it happen. And I did, and eventually it got me into a lot of schools, I'd say. because having Calc 3 is something most of my peers did not have. And last but not least, the burning question about race-based admissions. So for those that don't know, the Supreme Court had overruled that colleges can use affirmative action or any quota system for getting students from specific minorities. Common App had asked me what my racial background was. I maybe talked about it a little bit in some of the essays, but it definitely wasn't like a sob story, like, look at me, so sad, Hispanic and Black, or whatever the narrative is supposed to be. And of course, colleges also legally can't accept you based on your race. So I think that the stories I told and the stuff that I would have brought to the table is what got me in, definitely not my race or ethnicity. And that is all. Thank you all so much for watching. If you want more of these videos, let me know. If you have any specific questions, drop them in the comment section and I'll promise I'll answer as much as my ability. I might share my personal statement, some supplementals, and other more information later on. Just let me know if that's something you guys would be interested in. As always, thank you so, so much for watching, and I hope you have a wonderful rest of the day. To seniors, good luck on your college applications and reach out if you need any help.